So the other day we were talking about exponential functions, and we couldn't solve those equations except for with a graph until we talked about today's section, which was using logarithms. So now we could go back and actually do that question a second way. And that's one of the things that's important in this class, is that you see things kind of with both sides of your brain. You know, like what we did solving an exponential, like it was when is e to the x greater than a million, that question there that I'm talking about. And so we graphed it. That's using the right side. Anything graphical is using the right side of our brain. And whenever we solve things using equations and algebra, that's using the left side of our brain. Got to get those neurons strengthened between the left and right side. And so that's why in this course we do things graphically, algebraically, tabularly with tables as well. You know, that all helps to take and strengthen those neurons in your brain. All right, so first of all, a one-to-one function. You cannot have an inverse if it's not a one-to-one function. So something is a function if it passes the vertical line test. It's a one-to-one function if not only does it pass the vertical line test, but it also passes the horizontal line test. So a one-to-one function, it never takes on the same value twice. So some examples of one-to-one functions and not one-to-one functions, okay, let's see. This function right here is a one-to-one function. No matter, well, first of all, it's a function because it passes vertical line test. But no matter what horizontal line I draw, it also only hits it one time. Okay. Another parent function that's a one-to-one function would be this one here. Another one that's, let's do one that's not. Our good old parabola is not a one-to-one function. Because when you draw a horizontal line in, it hits it in more than one place. So this one is the only one here that is not a one-to-one function. And usually we just write this to say one-to-one. You know, you can write it just like that. So the question says, is this function a one-to-one function? And it's f of x equals x cubed. So you graph it. So you'll have some light graphing, or actually, you know, this here is a parent, so you shouldn't need your calculator on that one. But is it a one-to-one function? Because it passes both the horizontal and vertical line. Okay? Any one-to-one function has an inverse. Okay, so we need to talk a little about inverses. Well, not yet. Is this function a one-to-one function? F of x or g of x equals x squared. We kind of talked about that, so no. An inverse function. This is how we write inverse function. It doesn't mean 1 over f. Okay? When we have the function notation with a little negative 1 up there, it means inverse. And notice it says if f is 1 to 1, then f inverse would be the inverse of it. The domain, if the domain of f is a with a range of b, then the domain of f inverse is b with a range of a. Notice they switch. So whatever the domain of the original function is, that becomes the range of the inverse function, and vice versa. So here I have, what if I define for you that f of 1 equals 5? That means the graph of f has the point 1, 5. F of 3 equals 7 means the graph of f has the point 3, 7. F of 8 equals negative 10 means the graph of f has the point 8, negative 10. And it asks us to find f inverse of 7. Now remember, this here is domain and this here is range on these. The x's are your domain, the y's are your range. But as soon as you flip this around, look, the domain of this one was the range of this one. So when they say f inverse of 7, that means I need to look at the f function for where the y value is 7 and give the x value 3. inverse of 5. Look up here for where the range was 5, and that means the range of this one is going to be 1. F inverse of negative 10 is going to be 8. Okay. Now, we haven't quite gotten there yet, but again, I like to strengthen both sides of your brain. That's more left-brained. But what about a picture for right-brained? If I have the point 1, 5, it's this point right here. An inverse is a reflection over the line y equals x. So if I was to reflect this over to this side right here, it ends up being the point 5, 1. So 1, 5 on F is 5, 1 on F inverse. So sometimes we get caught up with like, well, what's that notation mean, you know? So what I'm saying for this next point is the point 3, 7. When you reflect it over this line, becomes the point 7, 3. Not drawn to scale here in any way, but these points are just reflecting over the line y equals x. So this was 3, 7. This one's 7, 3. So all of a sudden, when it's saying what's f inverse of 7, when the x value is 7, the y value is 3. Okay. Next. And these are just, again, some different ways of looking at things. F inverse of x equals y if and only if f of y equals x. So isn't that what we were talking about? The x of this and the y of the inverse become the y and the x of the original. Okay, it's just saying the same thing, which it's hard to look at like that. To me, this is what I call math jargon. All right, it's written in a mathematical way that sometimes is very confusing for our minds to understand. But basically it's saying if you have a point on F inverse that is the point 1, 9, it's going to be the point 9, 1 on F. Okay, saying the same thing we just talked about. Now, the other thing, and these are little negatives. I know it doesn't come out very dark right here because of the size of it, but F inverse of f of x should come out to x if f and f inverse are actually inverses of each other. And f of f inverse should come out to x if f and f inverse are actually inverses of each other. So last year in pre-calc, you had to prove that two things were inverses of each other. And how you did it, you had f of x and g of x at the time. Is you found f of g of x, and you found g of f of x, and you had to show that they both came out to x. Do you remember doing that? Okay, that was what you did. So here it says, determine if these are inverses of each other. So I have x cubed and x to the 1/3 power. So in order to determine if they're inverses of each other, I have to find f of f inverse of x, and I have to find f inverse of f of x. Both answers have to come out to x. So, f inverse is x to the 1/3. I go to my f function and I plug it in for x, and I get x to the 1/3 cubed. Well, 1/3 times 3 is 1, so I get an x right there. Then over here, I have f inverse of x cubed. I go to f inverse, I plug it in, x cubed to the 1/3 power. Is x. So yes, they are inverses of each other. It's not good enough that one of them comes out to x. You have to show that both of them do. Because there could be situations where one of them does, the other one doesn't. The other thing that I've seen kids get mixed up on is say the first one comes out to something like, you know, 5x, and the second one comes out to 5x. That's not good enough. It has to be just I remember doing that last year. So now, we have to also be able to find inverses, where they give us f of x, and from there we have to find f inverse. You have been doing this since it goes back to algebra 1. Okay. First, write the y in place of the f of x. Second, switch the x and the y. Third, solve the equation for y. And then fourth, replace the y with f inverse. Okay. Sometimes this step is forgotten, and so you get a little point marked off. So be careful, make sure that in the end you're saying f inverse is this, because that's what it's asking you for, is the inverse. All right, so it says find the inverse of this. So we start by replacing the f of x with a y. That's step one. Then we switch the x and the y. Put in place of f of x, put a y. Okay. Then from there, solve to get y by itself. So I'm going to subtract 2 from both sides. And then how do I get rid of a cube? Cube root, right? And the cube root goes over this entire side over here. So this is y equals the cube root of x minus 2 when I clean that up. And the final step is to replace the y with f inverse. So you just found the inverse. Okay. Perhaps the more difficult ones of those are the ones with fractions. You know, when fractions are involved within them. And I'm not talking like 1/2. I'm talking like x plus 5 over x minus 2 sort of thing. The graph of f inverse is obtained by reflecting the graph of f over the line of y equals x. So here's now the right brain thinking. Let's say this is y equals x. And let's say my graph is something like this right here. That's a one-to-one function, right? It's only half of a parabola, but that's okay because it does pass the both the horizontal and vertical line test. Okay? Let's say this here is the point 0, 2. One thing that's helpful is if you have any points, flip them and plot those points. So that means I have the point 2, 0 on my new graph. All right, now, I can tell you right now, when I go to draw these, I have to line my body up with that line. And many of you are that same way because your eyes see symmetry. I cannot stand on this side and draw it, okay? That's my own brain messing with me. And you may find this as you're doing it on your paper. If you line your body up with this line, then it's very easy for you to see where this thing is supposed to go. So try it on your paper, you know, move your notebook so that that line is lining up with your body, because then your eyes see symmetry when you're lined up with that line. That's why we see, like, a reflection over the y-axis very nice and easy, because we're usually straight on with it. Okay. The other thing you could do is you could try to figure out what some other points are and maybe graph those points and then kind of connect them. All right. But this here, if this is f of x, this down here is f inverse of x. Again, that's the right side of your brain working on that. Okay. Sketch, bless you. Again. Sketch the graph of f of x equals the square root of negative 1 minus x and its inverse. All right, could we graph that maybe without looking at a calculator? He says no. He's like, mm-mm, no way. Okay, well, let's try. Okay, Let's think about it. First of all, this is kind of in a strange order right here. Isn't it the same as negative x minus 1? Isn't it the same as negative 1 times x plus 1? Could I say that? So there's definitely reflection, right? And then it's also maybe moving right or left somewhere, right? So since the negative is out in front here, I'm going to say it's reflecting over the y. I'm talking from the regular parent function. And it's moving to the left one. So let's give it a try. You know, try to get yourself to do anything you can without your calculator. So it's moving, it's, first of all, if it started as this, I'm going to end up erasing that. It reflects over the y-axis, so it's coming over like this, and then it's moving to the left one. So my guess is something like that. And then check it on your calculator to make sure. Y equals, hold on, I got some stuff to clear out of here. Square root, negative 1 minus x, right? And let's do zoom standard. And there you have it. Okay. So that's just the original function right there. But again, I do try to get you guys to use a calculator as little as you have to with that. You know, try to think of the translations that we just talked about in section 1.3, okay, and the parent functions that we talked about in section 1.2. You know, like all of that's kind of coming together. So this here is f of x. Now it says sketch the graph of its inverse. It's not asking you to find the equation of the inverse, it's asking you to just sketch it, which means you can just reflect it over the line y equals x. Well, what point is this? This is the point negative 1, 0. So on the inverse, what's it going to become? 0, negative 1, right? Just make it right about here. And you start to see where this thing is reflecting. You know, having that line in there and having this here, you know, makes it easy for you to see, okay, this thing is going to come and go like this. Okay. Again, just asking you to sketch it. Is my graph perfect? Absolutely not. Okay. If I wanted to draw a perfect graph, I'd have to maybe have some grid paper or a ruler and have, like, the actual measurements the same. Okay, maybe plug in a few more points, but this is just a sketch. Okay, so you get the idea with reflecting over the line y equals x, right? All right, some logarithmic functions and properties that we've had over the years. If you have f of x equals b to the x, then the inverse almost looks like that, but it has a log here. And how we get that is we kind of use this rule right here that you've had in the past. That if you have log base b of x equals y, that's the same as b to the y equals x. If you have b to the y equals x, that's the same as log base b of x equals y. So I know that you all learn this from different teachers, and all of us teach it differently. Okay? I have a goofy way that I look at this because I used to always get it mixed up when I was your age. So I always create, like, stupid ways to remember things. And here's how I remember it. So I apologize ahead of time for my little story. But B and Y right here, they're in love. See them together there? They're close. They're in love. This guy over here wants to come between. Right? So in order to get a letter out of the exponent, log has to come into the picture. All right? These two that are together, yes, indeed, they get separated. And this guy comes between them. Now it works going in this direction as well. These two are now in love, but this guy wants to come between them. So these two get separated, and this guy comes between them. You know, so I know that's really stupid, and if you have a way to remember it, I think Mrs. Tolarchek does the bunny, but Ben the bunny. Yeah. Bend the bunny. She does something like that. So B-E-N becomes B-N-E or something along those lines. But we all, I know we do. We talk about it. We all teach it different. If you have a way you already know how to do it, use that way. Okay, I'm not saying you have to use my story. I'm just saying if you don't have a way, then, you know, use my story there. But that's where this kind of stuff is coming from. Notice, though, that these stay in the same order because it's an inverse. These down here are not inverses. It's just changing from what we call exponential form to logarithmic form. Or vice versa. Now, some other, what's that word I'm looking for? Properties. Is if these two bases are the same, the answer is just the exponent. So if you have something like log base 2 of 4 and you're trying to solve it, try to get these two the same. It means log base 2 of 2 squared. Once these are the same, the answer is, just the exponent. This one comes up more often in calculus than it did in pre-calc. If you have it, it's basically taking this and changing it into one form to the other. If you take this, these two that are together get separated and this guy comes between them kind of thing, or vice versa there, it ends up into this form right here. If you have B to a logarithmic power, as long as the base is the same as that base, then the answer is whatever you have there. However, and this is going to bring up another rule, if you have something like 2 to the 4 log base 2 of x, it's not just x. If you have a number in front, if you remember, the number goes to the exponent, 2 to the log base 2 of x to the 4th. Now these two, there's nothing between these. Since these are the same, the answer is x to the 4th. Again, you talked about that rule last year, but you didn't use it very much. Okay, it will come up in this class. Right when you least expect it to, as well. It doesn't come up a lot, but like when you least expect it, it'll come up. Some other rules. If you have logarithms that you have two things that are multiplied, you can take and give them each their own logarithm and change it to addition. So multiplication changes to addition, which that kind of goes back to our exponent rules. If you're multiplying two bases that are the same, it means you add their exponents. So multiplication and addition go together like that. Same with division and subtraction. And then this is that rule that I talked about over here. If you have an exponent, you can pull it out front, or if you have it out front, you can move it to the exponent. Depending on if they're asking you to solve something or expand something, you know, depending on their directions. So it says use the laws of logarithms to evaluate this. So several of you, right off the bat, you're like, oh, I just put that in my calculator and get the answer. Well, that would be on the non-calculator part of the test, so that's going to be hard to do when you go to take a test. All right? Here, I want you to use the properties. What does subtraction change to? Division. So that means log base 2 of 80 over 5. When you make the change from subtraction to division or addition to multiplication, one of the logarithms goes away. When you change it from multiplication or division to addition or subtraction, then the extra logs go in with each term. So, you know, remember that. And then from here, 80 divided by 5, well, I'd have to figure out what that is, and it looks like it's about maybe 16. And I can't stop there because it looks like I can write 16 as 2 to a power. So this means log base 2 of 2 to the 4th. Now that these two are the same, answer 4. So I use the laws of logarithms to find the answer. Could you use your calculator to check yourself when you're doing your homework and that kind of stuff? Absolutely, you could. Okay? Do you remember how to put a logarithm in on your calculator? So on your calculator, this alpha window right here, if you press those, you get this number 5, which is log base. It has it set up exactly how you need it. If you use this log key, it does not do that. Okay. So this would be log base 2 of 80. And then over here, well, actually, I don't want that yet. I need a subtraction sign. Okay. Now alpha window, and let's do that log base again. And 2, 5. And then press enter, and it will give you the answer. For me, it is faster for me to write that out than it is to type that in. You know? So, I mean, it's not, this right here is not bad work to do. Natural logarithms. Natural logarithms are another kind of logarithm, but their base is only the number e. So if you have a log with a base of e, we just rewrite it as natural log. You might remember when we talked about e on, what day was that? Wednesday, I think it was this week. When we talked about e, I said e comes up in nature. Why do you think it's called a natural logarithm? Because e appears in things with nature. Okay, and that's where it gets its name. The same thing goes here. If you want to take and change it to this form, if you had something like this, that means log base e of x equals y. These two that are together get separated. The other guy comes between them. So you can see that you can change it using the same rule. If you have natural log of e to the x, that means log base e of e to the x. It means the two bases are the same. So the answer is the exponent. So again, it's just all the rules that you already have for logarithms, but now you're using them with a base of e. E to the ln x means, yes, this has a base of e up here. And so those are the same, so the answer is just the value that's there. Just all the rules over again. And then here, this means log base e of e. What exponent is here but a 1? And so that's why, since these are the same, the answer is 1. So natural log of e, you will replace that with 1 many times throughout some of the problems. So the problem says, find x if the natural log of x equals 5. Well, remember, the natural log of x means log base e of x. Change it from logarithmic form to exponential form. These two that are together get separated. This guy comes between them. X is e to the 5th. So they just asked me to find x. I found x. I really like logarithms. Some people have bad experiences with them over the years and kind of have an attitude. Hopefully, you know, after practicing some things and, you know, if you didn't have a way to remember them, maybe my little story will help you. I don't know. Okay, you'll hear me say it multiple times as I solve problems. Next, solve this equation. It's currently in exponential form, and there's a letter stuck up in the exponent. That means I have to call logarithms to the rescue. I am going to take this and change it from exponential form to logarithmic form. The two that are together get separated. And this guy comes between them. What's another way to write log base e? Natural log. So this means natural log of 10 equals 5 minus 3x. Now solve and get x by itself. Now it becomes an algebra equation. Subtract 5 from both sides. So you have natural log of 10 minus 5 equals negative 3x. And then divide by negative 3. Now this here is an exact answer. Now you could write your answer as this right here. Or you could write your answer as this right here. Do you see what I did? Your textbook, no textbook that I have ever seen, and I've seen a lot of them, leaves a negative in the denominator. They pull the negative to the top. But then once in the top, they distribute it to both. And then they don't like a leading negative out front. So they would never leave a negative natural log of 10 plus 5. So switch it around. So this answer looks nicer and is how you might see it if you ever checked your work in a textbook or in an online program or anything like that. If you wanted to know what that answer actually comes out to, you could go to your calculator, say it's a fraction, 5 minus natural log is right below log, natural log of 10 divided by 3. And you could give the decimal answer. So if it's on non-calculator, you're going to give the answer we already gave. If it's on calculator and it says, you know, round so many places or whatever, 0.899. So there'll be a time and place for each solution here. Okay. So be prepared for either. Next, express this as a single logarithm. All right, so we're using some properties. First of all, if you have a number in front of a logarithm, where does it go? To the exponent, right? So this is natural log of a plus natural log of b to the 1/2. If you have addition between two logarithms, how can you change it to a single logarithm? Addition changes to multiplication. So we have the natural log of a times b to the 1/2. Or you might have the natural log of a square root of b, because a 1/2 power means a square root. Okay. Either answer is correct. Questions on that? So just using properties. Change of base formula is a formula that many of those kids on that back wall have had to use. But a couple years ago, right before you guys bought your calculators, even some of you might have had a calculator from a previous sibling, and your calculator needed updated. Our calculators didn't used to have where we had the button with the alpha and the window number 5 where it wrote it as a base like that. And so they had to use this formula all the time to use their calculator. So if you are using a smaller calculator or the calculator on your phone, like you guys all know that your phone has keys like this, right? Just turn your phone sideways and it opens up a bigger screen for you. If you have a logarithm that you want to find an answer to, and you don't have that one key to use, all right, you can use something called this change of base formula. You can rewrite this logarithm as two logarithms. This guy that's down at the bottom goes to the bottom. This guy that's up higher goes up on top. And that's an easy way to remember that. So you just take log of x divided by log of b. Or you can do natural log of x divided by natural log of b. It doesn't matter the base here. You're changing it from base b to base 10 or base e. As long as the bases are the same on the top and bottom, then it's still going to work. So if I have like log of 2 divided by log of 7, that is the same answer as the natural log of 2 divided by the natural log of 7. As long as the bases are the same. So it says evaluate log base 8 of 5 correct to 6 decimal places. If I ask you to use the change of base formula, you have to show me the setup. Just putting it in your calculator is only going to get you the answer point. It's not going to get you the work point. So this one here would be log of 5 divided by log of 8. You would get points for that and then points for your answer. So it's a fraction. And you're going to say log of 5, close your parenthesis, divided by log of 8, close your parenthesis. And it ends up giving me 0.774, oh wait, 6 decimal places. I can't remember that many. Let's see. 0.773976 would be the answer. Now, so that you believe me that this really works, let's now go to alpha window number 5 and plug it in exactly as we see it to prove to you that it's the same exact answer. Okay, again, your predecessors here that aren't much older than you, that are still in college right now, those kids had to use this. They were not lucky like you to have that button. Okay, if you find, and I think we've probably updated everybody's calculator over the years, if you find that you have a sibling's calculator and that key is not working on yours, just let me know. I can hook my calculator up to yours, and from there it takes 6 minutes and you'll be able to do it. Okay? So, but I think we've got you guys all. It took us the last couple of years. We've had about 6 in each class, you know, but I think you guys should be set because whoever you had last year, I'm sure, updated you. Next, how about graphing y equals the natural log of x? So this is a parent function. So we could type in natural log of x, graph it from negative 10 to 10, and this is what it looks like. So I need to speak to the mistakes that your calculator makes. Do you see how it looks like it starts right here and goes on? Your calculator has run out of pixels. This right here actually continues to come down. This is an asymptote right here, so this graph hugs that. So don't think when you see it on your calculator that it starts right there. It keeps going down forever and ever. The domain of this right here is from 0 to infinity, but does not include 0. The range is from negative infinity to positive infinity. You might remember, a logarithm is the inverse of y equals e to the x, which is your graph that hugs the x-axis. Oops, I didn't turn fast enough. And then comes up like that. You can see, if you fold it over the line, y equals x, that you have the natural log. So the inverse for this is e to the x. That's how you know that this thing keeps coming down, because so does this. But it doesn't run out of pixels horizontally. It only does vertically. Your calculator in function mode can't draw anything vertical. You have to change the mode of it in order to do that. All right. So some key things there are the asymptote and the x-intercept at 1, 0. Okay. So now it says, can you sketch this graph without a calculator? Well, you know that this means to move to the right 2, and you know that this means to move down 1. And so let's take that graph and move it to the right 2. That means the asymptote is moving here, and then it's going to move down 1. So this point that's right here at 1, 0 is going to be at 1, negative 1. Or, sorry, it's moving to the right 2 and down 1. So the right 2 would be 3, negative 1. 3, negative 1, right here. So it's going to come up like this. It's not going to cross at 3, 0. But those are the only points you know at this point, so that's all you could do. I guess I kind of went up a little bit steep that way. Okay, so you're going to practice graphing those as well. All right. This might be a really good stopping point right here. Okay, we're going to pick up with you guys on slide 16, so somebody can remember that for me. We only have the trig functions, inverses, more trig functions there, more trig functions, and then an empty slide. So we only have 3 slides left, okay, to finish up on Monday.